Hello, welcome to Living and Dying, the show that brings you news and information about the people and the activities of Brattleboro Area Hospice. My name is Richard Ewald, and I'm a hospice volunteer. Joining us today for a celebration of a kind, an anniversary celebration, are two folks from Brattleboro Area Hospice, Susan Parris, who's the executive director. Welcome,
Hi,
Susan.
Thanks.
And Andrea Livermore, the development director. And we are here today celebrating the 35th anniversary of the founding of Brattleboro Area Hospice. We're, as an organization, we're almost approaching middle age. we can't be irresponsible 20-somethings anymore, but we're not middle age yet. There's no crisis, fortunately. What an amazing period of time.
Yeah, we're really lucky to have such strong support in the community to be so well situated after 35 years.
A lot of nonprofits don't make it 35 years, let alone thrive in the way that Brattleboro Hospice has done. And as you guys know, the American hospice movement only started in the 1970s or so. Am I right about that?
Yes. I mean, the hospice goes back to the Middle Ages, where it was a kind of a way station for travelers, and then it was for people to go if they were dying and they had no family to take care of them, so monks and nuns would take care of them. And then in the mid-20th century, Cicely Saunders, a nurse in Great Britain, kind of founded the modern hospice movement. It came across the United States in the 70s, and in 1979, a group of volunteers in Brattleboro decided to found Brattleboro Area Hospice.
1979, back in the 70s, one of the good things that happened in the 70s, right? and since then, much has remained the same in what Brattleboro Area Hospice provides, in the sense of personal attendance at someone's bedside in their home. But American hospice in general has taken on a variety of other aspects that it didn't have at the time. The medical aspect I'm thinking of specifically, and that's an important way that Brattleboro Hospice is different. Am I right?
Yes. The reason that Cicely Saunders founded the hospice movement was a lot of people were getting shuttled to the back of hospitals and dying alone. So she really wanted to kind of bring them forward and hopefully bring them home to be cared for at home. So that still is a mainstay of Brattleboro Area Hospice. I mean, we work with people if they are in institutions or in the hospital right at the end of life. We're, of course, with them. But the majority of people have said over the years they would prefer to be at home when they die, with surrounded by their loved ones, and we continue to make that possible. So that part of our program is exactly the same. What's changed for us is that we've been able to grow and offer new programs, and we've really expanded our bereavement program, for instance, which is a component of hospice care. What's changed in the entire kind of country is in the 1980s, the Medicare hospice benefit was passed by Congress, and a lot of visiting nurses and hospitals started providing medical hospice care. So that is a wonderful thing. It brought in pain control, which was really really needed for patients, and it's been a wonderful, advantageous thing for people who are dying to have nurses and doctors to care for them at home. But the volunteer component can sometimes not be as prominent in the medical situation. And what's great about the Brattleboro community is they supported us, and so we have a very strong volunteer program, one of the biggest in the state of Vermont, and we have the biggest bereavement program in the state of Vermont.
Will you explain again what bereavement programs do?
It was recognized early on in the hospice movement that there's something called anticipatory grief that the patient and their family members were going through. So it's a sense of loss. You're losing something. Either you're losing your loss and your life, and there's the connections around your life, and then the people around you. They're losing their loved one, and then after a death, there is a period of mourning, and a loss goes on basically for the rest of your life, but there's the intensity of that loss right in that moment, and in particularly the first couple years. So early on, bereavement programs were founded, and what happens is we speak to family members and the patient before a death, and then after the patient has died, the family and friends and anyone who loved that person gets passed along to the bereavement program, and they're invited to have one-on-one counseling, or they can come to a number of support groups. Right now, we have a bereaved parent support group, a bereaved children support group, a support group for partner or spouse loss, and a general support group for all kinds of losses going on in our building today.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
It seems like when someone is dying, the family seems to come together, and then there's the person dies, and there's a memorial, and even more people come together, and then suddenly everyone leaves. And the spouse or the family is left with this huge vacancy, and this seems like a wonderful way to come in and be with them through that period.
Absolutely. And there are, one thing to point out is you don't have to have been a hospice client to use our bereavement program. Hmm. So any kind of loss that you've had, and it also, there isn't a time limit. So we've had people that lost a parent when they were young, and they come to a group now, and that was 30 years ago. I mean, you are continuing to process the loss, especially of a parent who isn't there for the various milestones in your life, when you graduated from high school, when you had a child, when you got married. So at different times, this loss comes up in your life, and people are, you know, encouraged to come and talk to us, and they also can be in support groups.
Mm-hmm. You know, we say Brattleboro Area Hospice so much, it's often easy to forget that it's really a regional hospice and serves people in a wide area, all of Windham County, a little bit of New Hampshire, maybe a little bit of Massachusetts, and the volunteers come from that area too. So if I think of the personal impacts over the years, 35 years of thousands of clients and thousands of volunteers, it seems that Brattleboro Area Hospice inevitably has deeply affected the culture of this county, this region.
Absolutely. I mean, I think there are people such as myself who went through the training and didn't go on to become a hospice volunteer, but then used what we experienced in the training with our own personal losses. You know, with my parents, it was incredibly helpful for me to have gone through the training. And so as the years go by and more people are touched by us in different ways, it is kind of a grassroots movement that kind of spreads out amongst the population. And we're dealing with something that every human being has to deal with. You know, I mean, there isn't anybody that you talk to, regardless of age, that hasn't dealt with some kind of loss. So it's an intrinsic emotion and challenge that we have to go through. So it connects each of us.
The little history you gave there mentioned medieval time and starting with monks and nuns caring for people, and that's, to me, comes out of a very intensely religious, personal place. And Cicely
Saunders'
intent was to, well, she needed to pull people out of the hospital so they could be in their homes. So there was a rejection of the medical right away. Let's get the medical out of here and let's just give them a space and take care of them. And then there's been this evolution that brought the medical back in more of a teamwork aspect in the home.
Absolutely.
Which sounds like a really great evolution.
Yeah. There's a lot of different organizations that work together to provide care when someone is dying. I mean, still, some of them still get Meals on Wheels, so that's Senior Solutions. They may have a chaplain. It could be through the hospice, or it could be their own minister or their spiritual guidance. There are friends and family, and then there's a social worker, there's a volunteer, hospice volunteer, and all that's like a team. It's called a circle of care. And it's an interdisciplinary team that that actually, lately, when they talk about improving healthcare in this country, they have turned and started using in other situations, not just end-of-life situations, like a team coming around a person who is being challenged by an illness and taking care of them. So it's kind of a group effort. It's really beautiful.
Andrew, before the camera started rolling, you mentioned some numbers about the first training in 1979.
Right. Right. Looking back, the first training in 1979, there were 50 volunteers turned out for that training, which for one training, which is, you know, gigantic.
So hospice is beginning. Hello, we're starting.
Right. Hello, we're starting.
We're going to train the class. 50 people show up.
Right. To help. And that first year, there were only 16 clients. So, but what happened was the hospice volunteers continued to meet with each other and support each other around what they were encountering in supporting these people at end of life. You know, until you've actually been with someone at end of life, it's really hard to imagine what that's like. And there's a certain reverence to it. There's a certain, it's like nothing you'll ever do, you've ever done before. And I think that kind of support is a really lovely thing.
Yeah, you mentioned you're taking the training right now.
I am taking the training right now.
Yeah.
And it's doing it with eyes wide open, I guess, is an interesting sort of way of thinking about it. It's, Susan was just mentioning the religious community, and at our very last training, we had a panel. We had someone from the Buddhist community, someone from the Jewish community, and someone from the Christian community came and talked to us, and just the different roles at end of life for those, and what those people have done with people at end of life, and how there are different traditions, and for different people, and how that's really important to them at end of life. And how one of my questions was, a lot of people who maybe have moved away from their religion of origin, if there's such a thing, do come back to it at end of life and just really wanting something to believe in and something to hold on to. And just understanding those things about what happens to people is really of interest.
I think it's worth noting, too, that Brattleboro Hospice doesn't make any distinctions about that.
Exactly.
And provides services to anyone of any faith and of no faith at all, and will not come in with a religious agenda.
With an agenda, no, not at, absolutely. I think one of the things that when you were talking about volunteers before that I think is important is that, you know, when someone is at end of life and there is this whole circle of care around a person, you know, family members are pretty preoccupied. You know, family members that might have had the role of, you know, cooking or taking care of the kids or whatever it is, it's a very all-consuming event. And volunteers can come in and just be helpful in whatever way that family needs, whether it's actually sitting with the individual and spending some time with them reading or just sitting so that a family member or a loved one can have a little bit of respite, can just go out for a walk and breathe, whatever that is. But it's also, they could be taking the kids outside, playing with the kids, or you know, doing some dishes, or just sort of taking care of those other kinds of little moment-to-moment details that we all have in our lives, just, again, to make the whole situation easier on those people that are intimately involved with it. And I think that's something that people forget about, particularly in light of the medical needs. You know, I don't know if we all are, but I'll say that many of us think about, you know, pain and not wanting pain, and that immediately moves you into the realm of the medical community, which is really important. And as Susan mentioned, we're so lucky to have palliative care and pain management available to us in other settings at end of life. But I think there's also a role for volunteers, and there's a role for both. And I think it's important for people when they're entertaining what they might need or want to just remember that, that it's not, you don't have to have one or the other.
Right.
You can have as much as you need. And that's sort of our mission, is to make end of life for the person experiencing it as well as their loved ones as easy as possible, whatever that means for them.
Caregivers need to be cared for too.
Exactly.
And that will give them some break. And I think it's important to remember too that volunteers aren't like company that needs to be entertained, and a lot of people have to get over that, don't they?
It's like having cleaning up before the cleaning person comes.
Yeah.
Exactly.
A lot of people are out there now who are trained, and you run into them all over the place. And is it time for a reunion? Thousands of volunteers?
Well, we had a reunion at our 30th anniversary at the Brattleboro Museum. Mm-hmm. And so we had about 300 people come. And so we invited people back to 1979. We have a number of volunteers that were trained in the 1980s that continue to volunteer today. So some people are still very connected with us, but we tried to find as many people as we could. I think we sent out probably about 700 invitations that we could find of people who have been involved mm-hmm. with us, and we had 300 people come. It was great. Wow. It was wonderful. And Pam Mayer, who has since passed away, is one of our founders and just really kind of the heart of our organization in the early days. She was there. And we have this lovely mm-hmm. picture that John Knopper took of all of us at the museum. It's really lovely. It's in our foyer. And we have it at our thrift store, mm-hmm. too, if people want to look at it. It's really great.
So it's neighbor to neighbor, care in the home, and yet this doesn't come free to, it comes free to people who receive the service, but mm-hmm. so it costs money to keep the organization going. How in the world has hospice survived for 35 years?
I think one of the major components of hospice funding is Experience Goods Thrift Shop, mm-hmm. which is, I think, probably one of the more successful downtown businesses. It's located on Flat Street. Most local people, if you say Experience Goods, they know of the thrift shop. It's amazing how the support that comes out of the proceeds of that store. There's a management team there, but there are also many, many volunteers from the community who help out at the store. So people who are committed to hospice and for whatever reason, volunteering with hospice clients isn't necessarily for them. Many people volunteer at the store, and that keeps the operating expenses down. People throughout the community know to donate experience goods, to donate clothing and housewares. And between the people who donate and the people who shop there regularly, it generates, on a year-to-year basis, probably around 60% or more of the operating expenses of the hospice mm-hmm. service delivery area. So it's amazing.
And the rest comes from individuals?
The rest comes from individual donations. Yeah. We have businesses who support us. We have an auction annually, which by the time this is aired, it will probably be over, but the auction takes place at the end of October, beginning of November, which is a great fundraiser. Again, people donate, you know, really fun and exciting goods, and they're auctioned off. People come, they buy things. It's really successful. A lot of local businesses this year, I think we have 30 local sponsors support that. But we also have individual donations from people throughout the community. We have donors ranging from people who can afford to make a $10, $25 a year donation up until people who are making over $1,000 a year of donations. We offer the ability to make recurring donations. You can do it with a credit card or a debit card, and you know, $5, $500 a month can be automatically deducted from your account. It's a great way for hospice to receive donations because it saves us mailing costs mm-hmm. Associated with those kinds of mailings we do. So we have the ability to do that. And we just really count on donations from the local community in support of our work. You know, keeping in mind our work is really low cost. Most of the work is done by volunteers, but it does take support and training and infrastructure in order to support those mm-hmm. volunteers. It's, you know, Susan mentioned the word grassroots earlier, and it really truly is a grassroots effort at heart, and it has continued that way, and is a really very, very good value. If you're thinking about value for your donation, it passes through quite directly to mm-hmm. the work that happens there. And hospice and bereavement services are available to everyone free of charge in the community. You know, our belief is that at that point in your life, it's not a time to make a choice between can someone pay or can someone not pay. Mm-hmm. It's a service of a neighbor, a friend, an acquaintance helping a friend, and we'd like to keep that free to the recipient, mm-hmm. so we're able to do that.
Yeah, I really like shopping at Experience Goods. It's a very mm-hmm. professionally run store. Great time of year to, you know, get warm clothes, mm-hmm. Christmas presents. I always rely on that. But that hasn't been there since the start. That came along
1989. Yeah, it was Chris McDermott and Allison McRae, two people who were on the board of directors at that time. They started collecting things and having kind of a yard sale of things, and they were carting things back and forth every weekend, and they said, this is ridiculous. We should just open up a store. And so they did. And it started out on Elliott Street facing Harmony Law and expanded three times in its space in Elliott Street, and then it kind of got too large there, and we moved down to the transportation center.
That's a great spot.
Yeah.
So anything planned to celebrate the 35th?
Yes. I'm really interested in how to get people to think more about their mortality in a safe way. And, because some of the challenges that we find with clients is that they come to us too late to really have some of their wishes granted. And so the earlier you start thinking about what you would like at the end of life, the better chance it is for it to happen in the way you want. And so we want to get people doing advanced directives and just kind of thinking in general about what it would be like. And so
not to focus on the negatives, but what are some of the things that people wish they had done? Didn't think of it, didn't have it in time, didn't set it in motion soon enough.
Often they don't get volunteers. If we get called, I think if you look at the national statistics, the average length of stay is a couple days. So people,
once you're called in?
Yes. So we've expanded the intake to be 2 years or less because we're non-medical and we don't get reimbursement. The Medicare hospice benefit is 6 months or less, and then you have to forego any chemotherapy or any treatment for cure. We also have a program where we don't require that either. You can still be getting chemotherapy and still get a hospice volunteer.
So I think that's an important distinction, that if someone knows that they're on that course, but they're not ready for medical hospice.
Right.
They can still receive volunteers in the home to help with things?
Absolutely. And it can be, usually those people are still very mobile, so it can be somebody that, could take you to doctor's appointments, can, take you grocery shopping, or just come and talk to you about what's happening, just a supportive person.
So in other words, they can still be pursuing a cure.
Yes.
And not have to give up, as people think, by saying, no, I'll take hospice. That's great.
Yeah, and also support for the caregiver. Mm-hmm. And what can happen sometimes is people get an initial diagnosis and they have, chemotherapy or radiation or some kind of, intensity of, and they need volunteers then. But then there's a period of time where everything is kind of settled and maybe they're in remission or something, and they can just kind of go on hiatus. And and stop having a volunteer or whatever. And then if it does take the turn to look like it's going to be terminal in a short time, they can call us back up, and they've already been in our system, and they can start getting volunteers again. So it's very flexible, and it's made that way because we've seen that there's been some challenges getting people to sign on to hospice.
So you're trying to be proactive.
Absolutely.
And get the word out.
And make it open to people.
Yeah.
And also just to get people in general. I mean, I'm sure people have seen, we've done a number of death cafes.
So if anybody hasn't seen it, what's a death cafe?
It's an international movement that started in Austria and Great Britain, where people just come and you have cake and coffee, so you need to have a treat and a beverage, and sit in a cafe setting and have conversation about end of life. And
In small groups.
Mm-hmm. And it can be whatever you want to talk about. So it's not guided. It's not like a training that hospice would guide and say, now we're going to talk about this. It's a spontaneous, you sit down with your piece of cake and you just start talking. So every table has different topics. It can be green burial, it can be grief, it could be my aging mother, it could be any of those topics.
And is there a hospice staff person there to answer questions or guide
there
in
is.
Some way?
Though the way that the movement goes, that you're not supposed to be facilitating the group, the group mm-hmm. can really go wherever it wants, but mm-hmm. there is hospice staff there in case someone were to have specific questions or get upset and need some support and things like that. So we
is there something you're still doing?
Yes.
Or there's some scheduled out?
Yes, we just did one in Guilford, mm-hmm. and the next one is going to be in Wilmington, though I don't have a date for it. Mm-hmm. And we do it in Brattleboro, so next year I'm sure there'll be one in Brattleboro as well.
We've also done them in Townsend. We did one at the Dam Diner in Townsend, and we've done one in Bellis Falls. Mm-hmm. So we've moved them around and had really, really amazing participation. People want to talk about it.
Sure.
It's really interesting.
Yeah.
And are these posted on the website?
Mm-hmm. They are.
BrattleboroHospice.org.
Right. They are. Mm-hmm. And so in that line for the 35th anniversary, I thought, for myself, I find art can be very mm-hmm. provocative in bringing up kind of emotions. If you see a film, a sad film, and there's like a family member that dies, you know what I mean? Like, it brings up things for yourself mm-hmm. and your own feeling and your own situation. So we have four different ways that people can kind of, access those feelings and explore those feelings in its very safe way. So the first is a concert that's a collaboration with the Friends of Music at Guilford. And that's on November 2nd. And all of these are on our website. The second is we're doing our Dia de los Muertos altar, which is a Mexican Day of the Dead altar. And we're also doing a gallery showing. We did some art workshops with the River Gallery School. Hmm. So we're going to show some art from those workshops. And that's on November 7th, which is Gallery Walk. And then on November 8th, we collaborated with the Brattleboro Film Festival, and we're going to be in the main theater. We're showing a film called Alive Inside, and it's an uplifting film. It won the Audience Award at Sundance about how music can awaken people with dementia. Mm. So on film, if you go watch the trailer, you'll see people that are kind of inside their own minds, not really kind of interacting with people around them, and they put headphones on them and they start playing music, and it's like they just come alive inside. Mm. They just wake up. It's incredible. And after the film, Kathy Leo from Hallowell mm-hmm. and Susan Dedell from the Brattleboro Concert Choir will be there doing a panel to talk about music and how it can access and support people at end of life and with dementia. And then the last thing is we're doing a staged reading of a play called Vesta, which is about a woman at the end of her life and her family. And it has some humor and some sadness in it.
Hmm.
And that's on November 15th, and it's directed by Bert Tepfer.
Wow. None of this was on the horizon in 1979.
No.
it sort of answers in a long way, in a very complete way, one of my questions about how has Brattleboro Hospice changed over time. Mm-hmm. And this sounds like one of it. Well, there's a lot more outreach.
Yes.
A lot more what you'd call education or just
right.
communication
mm-hmm. right.
with the idea of stimulating these conversations and these thinking about planning for what we really don't want to plan for.
Right, right. And I mean, there are many things in life that we kind of don't want to look at, but if we do, that's the reason that there's insurance, that's the reason, there's a lot of different things mm-hmm. that are set up in life because, however challenging it is, when you think of things that you, and everybody has stories about how it's gone badly mm-hmm. for, things that were unplanned. Mm-hmm. And so you also learn from those. You're kind of like, wow, I really would hate for this to mm-hmm. happen. And then you see something that kind of unfold and people will tell you, well, they died, but it was exactly as mm-hmm. they wanted. We were all with him, and it was so peaceful. And you think, and sometimes that can spontaneously happen, but if you want to try and make that happen, you at least have to put some of those things in place mm-hmm. With the hopes that it could happen. And so we're hoping to get people to think more about that and just be a little... put their toe in the water and think mm-hmm. about it a little bit.
A little more proactive, sort of having the conversation, thinking about the topic.
Mm-hmm.
But I think talking about it is a very big deal. I mean, we were talking before we started about there's so much in the media these days that oftentimes it's personal stories of end of life. And unfortunately, a lot of the times they're about end of life that didn't go well, mm-hmm. and realizing that you do have a choice, and you can put some things in place that increase the likelihood that things mm-hmm. will go the way you want mm-hmm. them to go. You know, I think one of the things that can be really challenging at the end of someone's life is the sort of discord that happens among the people who are left behind. Mm-hmm. You know, disagreement about what should happen. And I think if the person who's dying actually has made it clear to everybody what their wishes mm-hmm. are, it takes away some of that those challenges that can happen mm-hmm. at a really tough time. So, you know, our message is really talk about it, talk about mm-hmm. it. That's where death cafes have come in. So nicely, mm-hmm. and we'll continue to do that. I'm excited about these events for the 35th because I think, you know, they're all a little bit different, and hopefully different people will attend different events. I mean, people can attend all the events if they'd like to, but just again, planting that seed and being a little provocative about, you know, have I thought about that, or mm-hmm. what about this, or what about that? I think it's kind of lovely, mm-hmm. and we're, you know, Brattleboro is an arts community. Mm-hmm. We like art, so it's a great way to offer a venue, you know, that people are comfortable with and they enjoy to begin to introduce the topic as well. Oftentimes when you say hospice, people kind of want to take steps back. When it's really, you know, we would love for people to take steps forward and open up to the conversation anyway. So.
And of course, the thing that hasn't changed about Brattleboro Hospice is that neighbor to neighbor being with someone, the volunteer program, which makes Brattleboro Hospice unique.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And we believe worth the community support for another 35 years at least. And so please shop at the Experience Goods store on Flat Street. Please support these events that are coming up on the 35th, and make sure you remember Brattleboro Area Hospice in your own will.
Yeah, that's right.
And talk to Andrea about the various ways you can support the organization, which we're very happy to help celebrate the 35th anniversary. It's Brattleboro Area Hospice, BrattleboroHospice.org, 257-0775. And thank you very much for being with us. And we look forward to the next 35 years.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.